Is that a Naruto?
Hello everybody and welcome. Today we beat Elden Ring at Rune Level 1 as Ichigo Kurosaki. I had been planning on doing a Rune Level 1 run for a while, and in honor of the anime being continued with the Thousand Year Blood War arc, I thought, why not? But if you're worried about spoilers, don't be, because I haven't seen it yet.
What's that? Manga? Ah, never heard of her.
Obviously, I pick Wretch and do my best to make my character look like Ichigo. Which really just means orange hair and a pointy chin. Little sad there isn't really an anime protagonist hairstyle, but it's fine. Look at that hollow! Well, with complete disregard to myself, I will now fight it as I am the main character, and therefore have plot armor.
No, my plot armor!
So there are three primary weapons I'm going to use in this run. You can probably guess what they are, but there's actually a fourth weapon I want to try, just for fun. Before Ichigo received his Soul Reaper powers, he had the one and only Mighty Boot. So here I am, kicking Soldier of Godric into submission. It's tedious. Not even fun and rewarding, just tedious. I'm almost ashamed to say I felt kinda cool being able to dodge his attacks at the last second. Eventually, he goes down. Would you be surprised if I told you that this wasn't the easiest fight in the whole run?
I offer you an accord.
No thanks, I'm more of a 67 Impala kinda guy. So your name is Melina, right? I don't really like that name, so I'm just gonna call you Rukia from here on out. Okay, like every other run, we start by collecting the seeds and tears, which I just realized are kinda worthless because my health is never gonna be bigger than it is now. Well, I still need the medallion pieces, I guess. Someone's watched my Dovahkiin video. With that out of the way, it's finally time to collect our first weapon, the greatsword. So this literal piece of giant iron has a dex requirement of 12 and a strength requirement of 31. The dex is easy to get with Radagon's sword seal, but even while two-handing it, 15 strength isn't enough. But even without the ability to properly wield this weapon, it still does pretty good damage. Anyway, the good news is we can fix our strength issue with the Strength Knot Crystal Tier, giving us a temporary plus 10 to strength. Emphasis on the word temporary. Yeah, so the bad news is while I can use this weapon, it only lasts for 3 minutes. So basically, any bosses I fight are just gonna have a soft time limit on. Early game, that probably isn't an issue, but I'll have to make some changes eventually. First up is Margit, and oh, that is some chunky damage. Is this what it's like to use a normal weapon? What have I been doing with my life this whole time? Unsurprisingly, Margit is not an issue, and he goes down first try. With a second talisman slot opened up, I thought I would be smart and go get the Star Scorched Heirloom to give myself 20 total strength. But apparently I'm dumb and can't math, and 20 strength still isn't enough to two-hand the greatsword. There are pieces of armor that would raise my strength a couple more levels, and I think that should be enough, but fashion above functionality. Also, for those of you asking, no, I won't use Godric's Great Rune. That's basically 40 free levels, and even though it would solve my strength requirement problem, it just wouldn't feel like a Rune Level 1 challenge to me at that point. I decided to just go ahead and leave the talisman on because it should translate to a little extra damage. I plan on replacing it with the Blue Dancer Charm eventually because I don't plan on wearing much armor, but that isn't necessary for Godric. Speaking of, he's, not hard. I suppose this is kind of fitting for an anime protagonist. First few fights are just meh, and then in the end I'm getting absolutely shredded. Either way, Godric goes down first try. In Liurnia, I decided to buy a few shellfish to progress Blackguard Bogard's questline so I can ultimately buy Crab, then head into the tunnels where I learn the miners aren't big anime fans. Since runes don't serve the purpose of leveling, they can pretty much exclusively be dumped into smithing stones and other consumables. With that out of the way, it's time to make a decision. What do I do now? I need to down another Shardbearer in order to get into the capital, and my immediate options are either Rennala or Radahn. Rennala isn't particularly hard, as she's intended to be the second demigod players go after. The problem is, she's a two-phase fight, which would make that 3-minute window even smaller. Radahn, on the other hand, well, I highly doubt I have the damage output to down him in 3 minutes, plus I'm pretty sure he'd hit me with the "Omae wa mou shindeiru" just for looking at him in this state. I could also just go get my next weapon, but I wanted to use the greatsword just a little bit longer. While I contemplate what to do, I decide to grab the Blue Dancer Charm. Man, I'm gonna miss this weapon. Funnily enough, that was the wrong play, as I weigh so much with only the greatsword equipped, I actually do less damage with the charm than I do with a strength talisman. 357 and 370 respectively for jumping attacks. Oh well, it'll be useful later. After much contemplation, I decide to head to the academy. For once, the Red Wolf is actually kind of an issue. All of his attacks do a fairly large amount of damage. That's fine though, it's not like he has any kind of trap setup that combos into itself. Yep, that would suck. Second try goes much better. I even managed to get a poise break, which I don't think I've ever done on him before. It's always good to remember, no matter how many times I play this game, I still suck. Okay, time for the main attraction, Renala, Queen of the Full Moon. Did I come up with some crazy speedrun strat? Nope, I'm just going to hit her until she falls over. What, think I'm joking? No, not at all. Phase 1, the only real danger is the gravestones. I mean, sure, there are books that do chip damage and a falling chandelier, but one is negligible damage and the other is extremely telegraphed. Anyway, one hit regardless of damage is enough to break the Sweeting's shields, then Renala is just a setting duck. Don't get me wrong, it's really slow. Like, 6 cycles slow, which is 9 too many, but there really isn't any danger. I buff on the last cycle, that way I don't have to do it in phase 2, which, well, to be honest, was way easier than I thought it would be. I opened the way I do in pretty much any other melee build and was able to do half her health in only a few hits. Unfortunately, then she starts summoning things. They aren't hard to avoid, but the clock's a ticking, so I would like to actually fight her. Also, yes, I know I have upward cut on this weapon and it absolutely decimates Renala. I just forgot about it, but I know if I don't tell you now, you'll all ask why I didn't use it. Actually, now that I think about it, ask me anyway. Comments are good for the YouTube algorithm. Fun fact, in the middle of recording this video, patch 1.08 dropped with new hairstyles. None of them scream anime protag to me though. Anyway, now that the Soul Society, I mean Lindell, can be accessed, I think it's finally time to gain our next weapon. In preparation, I'm going to need more dexterity, and I can get that by doing part of Millicent's quest. Just gotta beat Commander O'Neill? Oh boy. I don't know why I thought this was a good idea. Clearly, the Unga Bunga went to my head. Eventually, he goes down, and good thing he did too, because I only had like 3 seconds to spare. After some back and forth with Millicent and Gowrie, I get the prosthesis wearer's heirloom, then it's off to Mount Gilmer to fight my sword for my sword. That makes more sense if you're familiar with the series, trust me. Anyway, Anastasia goes down and drops the butchering knife. This weapon has a hefty 20 dex requirement, which is why I needed both Radagon's sword seal and the prosthesis wearer's heirloom. I can't one-hand it with these 2 talismans, but that's fine. Next up is the Draconic Tree Symbol. Now, he hits pretty hard, so I make a quick stop to fight the Erdtree Avatar for the Opaline Bubble Tier. It'll be incredibly useful going forward, but then in the most me of moves, I forgot to put it in my physic. The smart thing to do would be to go all the way back to a side of grace and equip it, but it's been established that I only have 2 functioning brain cells and they are Unga and Bunga. So I proceed to throw myself at the Tree Sentinel for about half an hour before I give up and put the stupid thing in a stupid bottle. After just a couple more attempts, he goes down. Must have been the wind? I buy as much boiled crab as my pocketless pants can hold and it's off to the capital proper. Hey Rukia, how's it going? I haven't seen you in forever. Just doing side character things? Yeah, I'm out here saving the world. It's tough work, but some brightly colored hair having high schooler has to do it. Well, there goes that bubble tear. Y'all wanna see some real jank? I don't know if I've ever seen Godfrey not spin for that attack, and yes, I am blaming the game. Something something get good, I know. Aside from that, and occasionally getting clipped by Godfrey's stomp, he's not that hard. Then again, I'm biased because he is my favorite fight. Unlocking a new talisman slot, I immediately head over to the Lux Runes to grab the Ritual Sword Talisman. Since I can't really take hits, I'm pretty much always going to either be at full health or dead, so I might as well get the damage boost. Going straight to Morgott was a great idea. Seriously, the one cool thing I learned about this fight is that I can get a guaranteed stagger with proper positioning. Basically, if he jumps, run under him and do 2 full charge strong attacks, dodge the tail swipe, and rolling R1 him. To be fair, it might work for other weapons too, but I always love finding neat little niche uses for the ones that I'm using. Just makes the game feel more alive and less hit the enemy with stick until they fall over. Oh, and the reason I said with proper positioning is because sometimes his fat tail will straight up push you out of range. Thanks, Morgott. Eventually, he decided if it didn't work the first 30 times he tried it, surely the 31st time would be his lucky day. But it was, in fact, not his lucky day. With him down, I leveled up my weapon to take on the Fire Giant. Oh joy, how fun. Okay, listen, I know there are people out there that beat this game at rune level 1 with weapon level 0, no auxiliary effect, no rolls, no frickin' audio, I don't know, so it is definitely possible to beat Fire Giant the way I am now, but honestly, I'd rather power up again. Also, this happened, and yeah, that's enough Fire Giant for now, so how about instead I head into the sewers?
I hate this game.
Bog, you doing okay there, buddy? We just gonna stare longingly at each other until— okay, enough of that. I don't know what that glitch was, honestly. I reposted him next to the wall and he just kinda stopped attacking. Would've been cool if it broke his AI, but oh well, a few more hits and he falls. Y'all remember how the game tracks your stable ground position, and if you fall too far from that stable ground, it thinks you should take fall damage and die? Because I didn't. Whatever, it's time to fight Fia's champions.
Oh, this isn't gonna go too well.
You know, the worst part about losing to these guys is having to run all the way across this football field of an arena every time. It took me way more tries than I care to admit, but after finally claiming victory, I can talk to Fia and... Where's Fia? Oh, that's right. I haven't done neither her quest nor set the world on fire yet. Oops. Oh no, that guy who was so forgettable he literally only had one letter for her name died. Oh no. I already know someone is gonna be mad at me for talking about D like that. So, I am the big stupid. I had planned on fighting Fortisex and using the fact that I slayed a powerful dragon as a segue into my next weapon, but I haven't done literally any of Ronnie's quests that would allow me to do so, which means it's time to face General Radahn. I hate this boss. Radahn is... Well, he's about the point I really started to feel the whole level 1 thing. I mean, sure, up to this point there were bosses that hit hard, but if there was ever a boss that would just be named Vigor Check, it's him. He absolutely clapped me in this run, over and over. I hadn't realized until now, but I kinda rely on health in this fight to just survive his attacks and out-DPS him. I know I'm still using the Source Seal, which increases my damage taken, but I also don't really have a choice if I want to use this weapon. At some point, I go and get the Ritual Shield Talisman, hoping that somehow it'll help me survive his attacks. To be honest, I'm not sure how much it helped. The very next attempt was the winning one, and I only got hit 4 times. The first hit, the bubble tier, was still active. The second, I was blocking for some reason. The third hit, Torrent took the damage for me, and the final hit was only his gravity pull attack, which coincidentally is what allowed me to have an in for the win. I know I'm kinda glossing over this fight, but trust me, it took a long time and made me respect him a hell of a lot more. With Radahn finally out of the way, I can head into Nokron where I can fight myself for my bankai. I hate that I am the easiest boss in this game. With Bankai achieved, I am going to also pick up the Glintstone Wet Blade, that way I can put cold on this weapon. I know some of you are going to say, what? Ichigo doesn't use ice-based attacks? And that is true, but his Getsuga Tensho is blue, and in video game land, blue equals cold damage, so... I progress Millicent's side quest by giving her the Valkyrie's prosthesis, then head over to Windmill Village to get a taste of what's to come. Fortunately, I enjoy fighting the Apostle. Well, as much as I can anyway, and it's nice to get used to his moveset for later because I'm sure I'm gonna need it. Look, I know the real Ichigo would never do what I'm about to do, but Millicent's prosthesis is literally just a better talisman than what I have, and sometimes you just gotta make sacrifices for best in socket items. After Millicent so kindly gave me a hand in this run, I head back to Nokron to light the altars and take on the regal ancestor spirit. Hopefully this time he'll be a challenge. Nope, first try no hit. Maybe next time, Mr. Spirit. Now it's time to grab the Finger Slayer blade and... Now it's time to start Ronnie's quest line, so we take on Loretta, who's an early game boss, so she poses no real threat. Another first try no hit. At least it's a little practice for later. Up the tower, talk to the blue princess, grab her dagger, worst trade deal. Level vigor? Grab the curse mark, and with that, it is finally time to fight a dragon. I have a feeling this might be rough. And rough it was. Similar to Radahn, I am realizing that I usually do Fortisacks when I'm a smidge overleveled. Unfortunately, I didn't find any neat strats for this fight. I literally just stuck to his ankles and slashed away until he died. A pretty by-the-books big boss fight, honestly. The whole reason I did any of that right now, well, besides needing to down all remembrances, is because Fia's set completes the Shinigami look. Well, sort of. It looks better from the back. Alright, Fire Giant, I'm back, and this time, it's you who will take a knee. Well, two, I guess. Don't you know you shouldn't play with swords, Mr. Giant? Because you'll poke your eye out. Yeah, that was a good joke. 10 out of 10, me. Rukia, I'm just gonna take a little nap. Don't do anything stupid while I'm asleep, okay? Huh? What? Rukia?
Rukia, what did I say?
So Fire Giant was really kind to me, but that's way more than I can say about these two jerks. I spent 25 minutes running around avoiding every attack they threw at me, only hitting the Apostle one time for every chance I got. This was slow. Very slow, and eventually, an accidental buffer caused me to roll into his attack. Yeah, I'm gonna invoke the Godskin Duo BS clause on this and make the fight a little easier. I'm going to use Sleep Pots. Justification? Well, it's not breaking the Rune Level 1 rules, and it's only sort of breaking the theme. Either way, these things are hopefully gonna make my life a whole lot easier now. So I grab the cookbook and a few crackpots and make a handful of them. I'm the kind of person that is afraid to use any items if they only have a limited amount, and Trina Lilies don't respond, so I have to make these count. Why am I like this? Fun fact, I'm a double moron because I knew firsthand the Apostle dodges projectiles and I still threw it at him. I lied, I'm actually a triple moron because I didn't wait for him to enter the sleeping animation before I started hitting him either. I'd say this isn't going well, but I literally was able to demolish him before he was able to stand back up. The internet is right, sleep pods are broken for this fight. Oh, they use FP, I kinda forgot about that. Do I have anything that restores FP? No, I don't. Well, that's a problem. I decided I wouldn't go down without a fight. Having this boss at half health makes me more confident that I can beat them. But then I got greedy. Either way, next try I come prepared with some FP flask and learn that two charged heavies followed by an unsheath is enough to guard break them. Then, after the riposte, throw another sleep pot and repeat. This is probably the easiest time I've ever had with this fight. Honestly, unsheath isn't really an Ichigo thing either, but again, gods can duo claws. With them down, I now have the next smithing stone bell bearing and can use it to upgrade my weapon, so I... Wait, what are you doing past me? This isn't Hugh. Yeah, so I had a severe lapse in judgment, and instead of buying smithing stones, I bought shellfish. Well, whatever, I'm sure Malekith won't be that bad. Well, I guess I'm glad I didn't have any runes on me. You know what? This is a sign. Malekith is telling me to get stronger first. I was able to sell the large supply of prawn I was sitting on and a few other things to get my weapon to a plus 23, which is only one rank lower than it would be otherwise. Now we fight Doggo Man. Phase 1, not a problem. The rolling R1 is fast enough to easily get in and out of his window. Phase 2, slightly more of a problem. It wasn't anything worse than a normal melee run, it's just one hit is all it takes. Then I have to do the whole phase 1 again and just meh. Fortunately, I actually enjoy fighting Malekith, so it only takes a handful of tries before I get lucky and he goes down. Alright, so I was a little worried about Gideon. I mean, I don't exactly have a way to do huge burst damage to him, and a couple of his spells are rather large and difficult to avoid. Then I use the absolutely unbeatable strategy of hold forward and occasionally hit R1. Good job, Gideon, you're doing great, buddy. Quickly moving along to Godfrey, phase 1 goes exactly the same as before. In fact, it's actually easier because his moveset hasn't changed and halfway in he screams, which is just free damage. The only thing that gets added is the huge earth shatter attack, but the counter to that is to just run away. I know it's possible to dodge it with really strict timing, but honestly, it's better to be safe than, well, dead. Horalu is a tiny bit trickier, but honestly, all of his grabs have long enough windows to get at least one hit in, assuming you actually dodged them. I had the classic Dark Souls syndrome for this fight where my first attempt went really well, so I thought it was in the bag, only to get absolutely curb stomped for the next few attempts. Eventually, I'm on a run that's looking great, except Horalu here decided not to clip his fingernails and had just enough range to end me. Cool. Joke's on him though, because two attempts later, I pull the Uno reverse card and no-hit the whole fight. So that's neat. The Elden Ring resteth close at hand, but there's a couple more bosses I want to take on before the run ends. First up is Dragon Lord Placidusax. Oh, it's gonna be like that, is it? Well, I'm sure glad runes are basically worthless in this run, otherwise I'd be a little bit salty I just lost 300,000. I didn't realize how much health Placidusax has, or maybe how little damage I'm doing, until the big laser when I sat here just wailing on him and hardly did anything. If it weren't for the frost proc and the poise break, the fight probably would have kept going, which means I probably would have died. I want to fight Mog next, but to do that, I need to get to the consecrated snowfield. Listen, buddy, I already fought your cousin, so I know all your moves. This is a mind game. See, now he thinks he's better than me, and he'll get arrogant and pride cometh before the fall. The actual fight isn't any different from a normal melee encounter, and after he goes down, we enter Frigid Outskirts version 2. Making a snap to get the Purifying Crystal tier that I totally got first try, don't question it, I meet the Blood Lord himself. I rolled backwards into the blood flame, causing me to lose my shield and 100% health buff. GG, Mog, you got me. The real reason I decided to do Mog now was because I knew he wouldn't be particularly hard. I find melee to be the easier way to fight him, since sticking close to him means dodging all the blood flame spells just by basically dodging his regular swings. I once again noticed the pitiful amount of damage I'm doing per slash, and that worries me for a fight to come, but I guess that's what the occasional bleed and frost proc are for. On the winning attempt, I actually ended up no-hitting him, and I'm doing that a lot this run, but I think instead of skill, it's out of necessity because getting hit is, not favorable when you have 10 vigor. Over in the Hallig Tree, I tried to do the cool speedrunning skip, but it's kinda hard to do without a parry shield. Hey, it's you again! Draconic Tree Sentinel, right? Ah, I never forget a name. Loretta is virtually unchanged since the last time, just with more health and more arrow, but as the saying goes, if it bleeds, it can kill me. Ah yes, the only thing that can defeat anime. And okay, it's time to talk about Melania. I was timidly confident going into this fight. I mean, I've handled Melania dozens of times, and in some of those attempts, I've almost no-hit her, so I just need to do the same here, right? How naive I was. Realistically, there's only one attack in her whole kit that's a problem, and you can probably guess which one it is. Waterfowl. So I'll say it. I am complete garbage at dodging this attack if she does it from point-blank range. I know it's not hard to dodge if there's a little bit of distance, just run away from her and time a couple dodges, but from right up in her face, I just can't. I also know there's a strategy where you unlock the camera, run around her, but I keep getting stuck on her foot and just die. The actual issue in this run lies with the attack being a multi-hit and me having low poise. If she so much as clips me with a single slice, it usually means death. I say usually because a couple times I did escape with my life, somehow, but that was the exception and not the rule. Phase 1 actually isn't an issue because she's so passive it's really easy to bait out waterfowl. Phase 2 is when rot hits the fan. She's suddenly so much more aggressive and up in my face that whenever I go for an attack, if she decides that she wants to unalive me, that's just it. I threw myself at Melania for hours before I decided I needed to change something. So first, let's add a new movement technique to our abilities. Over in Caelid, I say hi to this nice cavalry before telling him my favorite dessert. Strawberry cheesecake. Bloodhound step is basically flash step, so it's more fitting than unsheath anyway. I also thought about changing my weapon, with the only two contenders being Moonveil and the Darkmoon Greatsword, solely because of their Ash of War is actually shooting a beam of energy out. However, they both have really high intelligence requirements. Not so high it isn't doable, but it would basically involve using both Sword Seals, the Stargazer heirloom, stat boosting gear, and in the case of the Darkmoon Greatsword, the intelligence knot tier, so it would be on a timer, and this late in the game, that's not exactly ideal. Anyway, back to Melania, my plan now is to just Bloodhound step around when she waterfowls. Oh yeah, I forgot. They nerfed Bloodhound step into the ground. I ended up finding a nice little strategy of hit her once, then flash step backwards and immediately run away. If she waterfowls, there's enough time to dodge it. If she doesn't, repeat until she does. This was by far the hardest fight in the whole run, just because I could play perfectly, but if she decided the fight was over, it was over. Eventually though, like all before her, she falls. Up next, I wanted to try Rykard, but I didn't want to do the invasions because, well, I suck at NPC fights and it just seemed like a bad idea at Rune Level 1. So I make my way through Volcano Manor, and by that I mean I get lost in the manor and die, then eventually make my way to the Godskin Noble. I won't waste your time, Mr. Noble, just take a nap, then let me hit you with, oh crap, I don't have unsheath on this anymore. That's fine, improve, adapt, overcome, or something like that. Nothing personal, kid. Oh shit, wrong way. Nothing personal, kid. First try. Alright, Rykard time! It didn't work. The bleed and frost procs definitely helped chunk his health off, but the whole 10 vigor thing basically stops this from happening. I used all of my healing flasks and didn't even manage to get past phase 1. You might be able to optimize, wear heavy armor and super poise, but even then, he still has a whole nother bigger health bar. Oh, look at that! Ichigo found the super secret weapon! Neat. This actually still took me a couple of tries because I'm the big dumb and back rolled into the exploding skull that I couldn't see, but overall the fight is extremely easy because of the Serpent Hunter Spear. Alright, it's finally time to finish this shit, I forgot Estelle. My only advice for him is that Bloodhound Step is great for avoiding his grab attacks. Still a gamble if you can dodge the meteors though. Now it's time to finish this fight. Radagon of the Golden Order. Honestly, after this run, he might have become my favorite fight, and I got good at it. I mean, I got really, really good at fighting him in this run. Like, to the point that several of my attempts on him were no hits, including the winning run. Elden Beast, on the other hand, kind of a buzzkill, honestly. A lot of you probably think Elden Stars would be an issue, and it's not that it wasn't, it's just that this random holy arrow attack was a much bigger one. I'm sure it has to do with the angle that the attack came at me, but it felt like I couldn't just run away from it. I guess maybe I zigged when I should have zagged, I don't know. After a couple of hours though, Elden Beast falls before us and Ichigo Kurosaki at Rune Level 1 has saved the Soul Society. Guess now I should go watch the anime before it gets spoiled in the comments. Big thanks to my amazing patrons, stay beautiful y'all, and until next time my friends, don't you dare go hollow.